Hello everyone. In this video, I'm going to walk you through the new features added to the latest Power Query update. So what's new in Power Query? This month we just added support for loading binary type columns into the data model. This is quite useful, especially when you're trying to work on some reports for which you would like to include images downloaded from a data source. And there's two main scenarios for this. One is, for instance, downloading binary data like images from a data source that supports binary. For instance, from a database, you could load a binary type column or a blob column. And the other one, it's about downloading images from the web. So one common scenario that I'm going to show you is downloading images from a specific HTTP location. So moving over to this Excel workbook, I have a few queries in here. And the first one that I wanted to show you is getPerson. This is a function, and when I invoke it, I'm actually going to be able to get the result. In this case, is going to be a few columns with my alias, name, office, and title. So now this is connecting to an internal Microsoft API that will download basic employee information. And you see how there's also a picture column, a binary column. So let's close this and go back to see the implementation of this function. So I'm going to go into edit for getPerson, and I'm going to show you the underlying steps. So going into the advanced editor, you could see how what I did here was first connecting to this API, HTTP who people store, and I was passing in the employee alias. And then I start removing a few columns, expanding a few other columns with the name, the office, and the title. And the step that I did in order to download the image is right here, is web contents of exactly HTTP who/photos and then the alias.jpg. So basically you would use web.contents to download whichever data or whichever file is contained or referenced by the following URL. And once you've done that, the last thing is to just change the column type to binary, which you could do from the home tab in the editor using the data type dropdown over here. And once you've done that, you could just download that query into the model. So that's what I did with the PQ team query that I'm going to show you now. Here, I simply used the previous function, given a list of people, and I ended up getting all of the employees working, or all of the people working on the Power Query team, along with their aliases, their names, their office, and their titles, as well as the pictures. So at the end, I just downloaded that to the data model, and now I'm ready to go and prepare that set of images for visualization. So the first thing I need to do is go into the Power Pivot Manage window, select my Power Query team query, and go into the Design tab and use the Table Properties dialog. So now this is a temporary limitation for us, and the reason why we have to come into this dialog is because binary data, binary columns are automatically hidden when loaded into the data model. So you have to go tell Power Pivot to actually make those columns visible so I can consume them from other tools like Power View. So this is going to load the preview of the query, or the preview of the data model table, so that I could customize the properties. And all I need to do here is make sure that the checkbox next to the picture column containing the binary data, it's enabled, is checked. And then I'll just save this. And the next thing I have to do is specify that that picture column is going to be my default image. And for those of you familiar with Power Pivot, you know that you'll have to go into the Advanced tab for doing that. And that's what we're going to do right after I finish enabling this binary column. There's quite a few people. I think it's about 28 people, actually. So there was quite a few binary data blobs to load. So I have to go into the Advanced tab now and go into the table behavior. And here I'll specify the raw identifier, which could be the alias. It's a unique field of information for Microsoft employees. And I could use even a default label, such as the name. And the default image is going to be picture. So now that I've done that, I could close Power Pivot and go insert a Power View report. So we'll go into the Insert tab and click Power View Reports. It'll create a new Power View sheet for us. And I could go ahead and just close the workbook queries pane so we get a little bit more space. I'll close the filter pane. So I have a few queries, but here's my PQ team query. And I'll just go ahead and pick the picture and then I'll pick the name, the alias, the office, and the title. And you see how Power Query team members start to show up. And now I can, of course, customize my report, and I could maybe even turn this into a card, make it a little bit smaller over here, something like that. So you see how easy, relatively easy it is to download these pictures. So the key point here is now that even though these images were stored or are stored in a HTTP location, just by virtue of using the web.contents function that I invoked through Power Query, I've downloaded this data to the workbook. So now even if the images went away from the web, I have them stored locally in this workbook's data model, and I can play with them just as I could do with any other data model data. Alright, so that's it for the first demo, for the first feature included here. Not an easy one though, and I think it's a pretty exciting one, and it opens up a lot of capabilities in terms of working with web APIs. Think about social data, Twitter pictures, Facebook pictures. We didn't get into that, but you could actually use the Power Query Facebook connector to start downloading binaries such as your Facebook photos and visualize them in Power View. So now let's go take a look at the other features included in this update. The second one is multi-query editing. So for those of you who've been working with Power Query for a little while, you may have realized that the workbook queries pane, it's a great view for all of the queries contained in my workbook. But in case I want to edit them, I'll have to go open queries one by one, make some changes, close them, go open another one, make some changes, close it, and so on and so forth. So we decided that it would be really great if you could, within the query editor window, just start performing changes to a query and be able to switch to a different one. So we've added a navigator pane here over on the left side that effectively replicates the list of queries or even the hierarchy of queries if you have defined query groups. So I could just go ahead and start doing things like picking a few columns here on the products table, removing them, so I'll make some changes to my query. Then I'll go ahead and move to the customers query, and you see how it automatically flips my query settings pane, all my steps, and the preview now reflects the stuff on the customers query. And maybe I could do split this column, or maybe I could do something like just formatting this differently, like for instance with uppercase. And so I could easily move between queries and start working with them in a single window instead of having to go back and forth to the workbook queries pane in the Excel window. And at the end of the day, once I've done a bunch of changes and I try to close the editor, it will just ask me if I want to keep or discard all of the changes that I made in this session. And the other thing that I could do here is even right click on a query and duplicate or reference it from here. So I could even create new queries from this window. I'm going to discard those changes. So that would be for the second feature. We believe it's also a power user feature for Power Query. So in case you're working with a bunch of queries, it will reduce the amount of back and forth you'll have to take. The next group of features, there's two of them, and it's in line with our ongoing effort for making it easier to perform more transformations. So the first thing we added is a new transformation for pivot columns. So we'll go into this group that I have here with pivot columns, and I have my total population query, so let's go into it. So usually we do this demo the other way around, which is you have a table with a bunch of columns that you would like to unpivot. So that feature has been there for a while, and pivot has actually been available in the Power Query formula language, but it was not properly exposed through the editor UI. So that's what we just did this month, and now I can go ahead and select, for instance, the year column. I will go into the transform menu, and I have pivot column on the second group, and I could just go ahead and click it, and it will ask me what's the column that holds the values, and in this case it's going to be the population one. And I have a few advanced options, such as the aggregate value function that I would like to use. I might want to sum all of the values available for that values column, or I could do things like just don't aggregate it and just use the single element that's available there, or I could do mean, max, average, and so on and so forth. So in this case, let's go ahead and do the sum. And this is going to pivot my table in the following way, so that I have my country name columns, and then I'll have one column per year. So actually, if you think about unpivot as the inverse of this, it would feel really natural that now I could go ahead and say unpivot all the other columns except for country. And when I do that, I basically just round trip. So if you look back at my steps, I had this shape, I pivoted it, got a bunch of columns, and then if I unpivot, I'll go back to the exact same shape. So think about pivot as the inverse operation from unpivot, and think about all of the opportunities that that brings up in terms of reshaping your data and being able to customize it even better. All right, so that would be for pivot columns. The next feature, number four on the list, is automatic type coercion, so that I could start with a column that looks like a date time, for instance, or a number, and I could apply text operations to it. So let's go back to my workbook, and let's go to the order details query. And here I have the following table, in which I have, for instance, an order ID, which in this case is actually a number, and so is the product ID. So let's say that for some reason I want to do something like merging those two columns. If I had to do it before this update, I would have to manually turn each of them into text, and then I would go and just apply the text operation that I want. But now, if I go to the Transform tab, you see how the text column operations are available. So in this case, I could go ahead and do a merge. And I could merge these two columns, maybe use a separator. Let's say I want to use a custom separator, and I use a dash, and click OK. So see how now we merge this column. And if you look a little bit closer to the formula that we generate, what we're actually doing behind the scenes is effectively just changing the type of that column and then applying the text operation. Even more, I could not only do the transform operations, but I could also add new columns. So let's say that I take quantity and discount, and I would like to add a column that does the same merge columns operation. And in this case, let's say that I want to use comma. So here is my inserted merge. And in this case, if you look at the generated formula, what happened here is that we first combine, and then we created the new column. So that'd be it for type coercion. I think this is the first step in the longer set of a step, in a larger set of steps in terms of type coercion. You could see us leveraging things, leveraging this for things like merging multiple queries, and if you pick columns of different types on each of the tables, we would have to figure out what's the right common type between them, so you don't need to transform or change the types up front. And you could see us adding more and more of that, so we reduce the friction around handling column types within your queries, all with the idea of simplifying more and more all of the transformations and merge operations that you could apply in Power Query. All right, so the next set of things are little usability improvements. They're all things that were possible before, but now we've made them easier. So for instance, the first one is the query properties dialog. If you recall from previous versions of Power Query, inside the editor, you would have, in the query settings pane, you would have the name of the query, and you will have the description. Now, we've moved the description into a different box, and if you click here on all properties, it would open that box. And we think that over time we'll have more properties, but for now there's just these two. And this looks very similar to the dialog for creating a new query group, actually, if you remember that one from the previous update. But here I could add a description for this. So this is my orders. This is my orders query. And I have my description now. And I could also access this dialog from the Home Ribbon tab, exactly the same. But actually, the one that's probably more interesting for many of you, because we've heard that feedback from you a bunch of times, is that you would like to customize the name and the description of your queries from outside of the query editor. So I'm looking at a query right here in the Workbook Queries pane in Excel, and I could just go ahead and say, right-click Properties, or even I could go into the contextual query tab in the ribbon and say properties right here, and it will let me change this name of a query. So I would say total population by country, for instance, and that will automatically change the name of my query, as you can notice here. So again, trying to make some of the things that were possible before easier and faster, so we optimize your workflow. The next one, it's also in the same line. If you have ever used the share query experience, you may remember how it used to be such a big dialogue with 6 or 7 different input fields, including the name and the description of the query and the data sources list and documentation URL and the list of people you would like to share with and an option to include or not include a preview when you share. Now we've simplified that, and well, the first thing we did is rename share query to send to data catalog, so it makes it more clear that what we're doing is take a point in time copy of this query and send it over to the Power BI data catalog. So now when you go into that dialog, you see two different tabs. You see the query tab, which holds all of the query properties like the name, the description, and the option to include or not include a preview. And the sharing tab, which includes the options for deciding who to share with, if I just want to share with me, everyone in my organization or my enterprise, or specific people and groups. All right, similarly, back in the Power Query tab, we've renamed share queries to my data catalog queries, and you notice how this button has now moved to the Power BI group next to the sign in sign out, while before it used to be on the managed group next to workbook queries. So trying to separate them a little bit more, make it more explicit which option does what, and so we clarify a little bit the capabilities in the product. All right, the last feature, it's about making it easier for you to enable tracing for Power Query. If you've ever had any issue with performance or some errors in Power Query and send us a frown or send us a message in the forum, you might have received from us a blurb with 5 or 6 steps, including modifying the registry to enable tracing in Power Query and then recording traces and sending them to us. So we just wanted to simplify that process. So now if you go into the options dialog, you have a group at the bottom, diagnostic options, that would let me enable Power Query tracing for the current session. And the interesting part about this is that we will turn on tracing. And then once you say, okay, we'll turn it on, start recording whatever you do. So for instance, I refresh that query, we're gonna start generating traces for that. And then once I close the workbook, I'm going to stop recording traces. And this is pretty important because in the past, maybe you enabled tracing and you forgot about it, and that folder with traces would grow and grow and would expand to gigabytes and gigabytes of data taken into your hard disk. So now that I've done that, I could go into my Windows File Explorer, and I would go into my Power Query local app data folder, which is under your user folder, app data, local, Microsoft, Power Query. And you have a traces folder, which is just recorded right now. As you can see, 8:37, just a minute ago when I issued those refresh operations. And then you'll find a bunch of traces, and we're not gonna get into the details because this is mostly implementation details and interfaces and function calls internal to Power Query. But the message here is that now you can easily just, for instance, zip this and send it to us over a frown or through a forum, and it would help you not have to go and manually modify the registry key for enabled tracing. And over time, we hope to even simplify it more, but of course, that will come with latest and newest updates. And we hope you like this one. Send us feedback. We always appreciate that. And keep sharing your thoughts about new features and the stuff that we could add to the product, because we're really willing to make it easier for all of you to use Power Query and to make it even more productive in your daily work. All right, take care and see you next time.